So welcome to everyone to this very fascinating series of lectures that we are going to host at CEU, part of our 20th anniversary celebration. And I think the most important part, of course, is reflection on who we are as a university and what universities are in society and what some of the large themes, ethical and social responsibility themes are. And it's my great pleasure as president and rector to simply introduce this series and then very quickly turn it over to Professor Judith Chandor, who will introduce our distinguished lecturer. But I think anniversaries sometimes are celebrated too much with bells and whistles and not enough with intellectual and careful self-reflection. And when we sat down about a year ago in a group that was beginning to plan how CEU might mark its 20th anniversary, which of course is just a blip in time for many universities in the world, it's only 20 years, we decided that the best way to do this was to really be more self-reflective. And that was why we picked this theme. One of the themes that we picked is the theme of social responsibility. Another theme that we picked, and I won't talk at length about it, but just to show you the kind of reflection that I think we're engaged in here, is information in the 21st century and the incredible flow of information that comes across all of us and the difficulty of managing it and making judgments in an information world. But social responsibility is at the heart of what we're doing here today. Our Center for Ethics and Law in Biomedicine, which is ably headed by Professor Judith Chandor, is the sponsor inside CEU of this lecture series. And it's my great pleasure at this point to turn everything over to Judith so you can introduce our distinguished lecturer. I haven't even said his name so that you will be desperate to hear more. And here it comes. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for this general introduction. Ladies and gentlemen, dear Mr. Rector, Professor John Harris, colleagues, students, and guests, present and future generations. At the beginning of the 21st century, new scientific findings and technological solutions, new inventions and applications emerge one after the other with an astonishing speed in the field of life sciences. Stem cell therapies and regenerative medicine, genetic testing, screening, synthetic sunshine and artificial photosynthesis, cognitive and mood enhancement, bionic arms, intelligent implants. These techniques and solutions all provide new possibilities to improve our life, even to correct and to enhance it. New disciplines and new interdisciplinary research fields are formed. States and private companies cooperate and compete to push scientific developments even further. Nevertheless, the farther scientific development goes, the more questions emerge about the possible ethical, legal, social, and cultural implications. Academic communities, governments, agencies, scientific researchers and patients, politicians, non-governmental organizations frequently ask the question, are these new technologies safe? Are they effective? Do they have any harmful influence on those who apply them? Advances in embryonic stem cell research, gene therapy, synthetic biology, and many other fields of bioscience have generated considerable interest also among the social and cultural sciences. This interest emerges primarily because these scientific developments challenge or taken for granted understanding of the relationship between body and mind, between nature and nurture, between human and animal, or between flesh and machine. The practical possibility of the existence of chimeras and cyborgs change our perceptions and conceptions or Wonder Woman and Wonder Man and the boundaries of identities. And these new solutions and possibilities are exploited, new needs for regulations also come forward. So what is at stake? Can and should we exercise meaningful control over scientific developments? Can we improve, alter, or enhance our body, or memory, or reproductive capacity? And if we individual human beings and members of the society can be so easily altered, and what happens with our identity? After raising these uneasy but challenging and stimulating questions, which have motivated our multidisciplinary research center for ethics and law in biomedicine in the past 6 years, I would like to introduce the anniversary bioethics lecture series, which our center's contribution to the celebration of the 20th anniversary of establishing our dear alma mater, the Central European University. The lecturer today, for many of you, do not need a specific introduction. For a multidisciplinary audience, maybe some words could be mentioned about him. Professor John Harris is a Sir David Alliance Professor of Bioethics at the Institute of Medicine, Law and Bioethics at the University of Manchester. He was educated at the University of Kent and Balliol College and one of the founding directors of the International Associations of Bioethics. Several of his books has been published and we use in our teaching materials here at CEU at several courses. Just let me mention some of these books, Wonder Woman and Superman, The Ethics of Human Biotechnology, and also Enhancing Evolution. I would like to give the floor to Professor John Harris. We are very privileged to have him here, and I'm sure that his speech will also provoke a very fruitful debate among our colleagues. Thank you very much.
Thank you both very much for such a warm welcome here and such a grand introduction. President and Rector, two roles in one. Students and colleagues, I think everybody else falls into those two categories. It's a singular honour for me to be here with you to help celebrate the 20th anniversary of the Central European University. CEU has established itself among the elite academic institutions with a well-deserved reputation for excellence in teaching and research in social science, humanities, law, and I understand neuroscience as well. That was not on my original list. The exceptional contribution, in particular, of the Centre for Ethics and Law in Biomedicine, CLAB, to the development of bioethics and human rights is very well recognised. And I personally am delighted to be able to be here to acknowledge the crucial role both of your president and of Judith Chandor in CLAB's great success, and to congratulate you all on the truly wonderful work you're doing here. It's my first visit to Hungary and indeed to Budapest, but I've been boning up on the work of both this university and CLAB, and it's a very, very impressive outfit. Let me turn now to my talk for today. I received a film of another guest speaker that you've had recently, and that's Ronnie Dworkin, who I believe was talking in this very room. Now, Ronnie was my PhD supervisor at Oxford, and I selected him, among other reasons, for this reason, that when he gave his inaugural lecture as the new chair of jurisprudence, it was customary to wear gowns at the University of Oxford, and he very ostentatiously came into his inaugural lecture, not wearing his gown, but carrying it. He placed it on the chair next to him, and never wore a gown again. And as a result of this, everybody else started not wearing gowns to lectures. Now, I'm going to, in a very modest way, follow his example by having put on a tie to show you that I've got one. And because it's not because it's a very warm day, but in memory, although he's still alive and with us, of my former supervisor, I'm going to take off my tie, not my shoes yet, and relax a bit. The presentation I'm going to make today is a version of a paper that I wrote with my friend and colleague John Sulston. Some of you may know that John Sulston was awarded the Nobel Prize in 2002 for his work ostensibly on sequencing the genome of C. elegans, the nematode worm, but in particular for noticing during his work on C. elegans a phenomenon that has come to be known as programmed cell death, which is incredibly important in a whole range of new work in science. Now, why I'm telling you that we worked on this paper together is not only so that I can harness his reputation as a Nobel laureate to the few modest things that I'm going to say, but also to point out that since this was a joint effort, I can share the responsibility, or rather hive off the blame, for any errors that this paper contains. So all of the bad stuff is John Sulston's, and all of the good stuff is mine. And John knows that I routinely say that. Let me just start with a claim, which I believe to be true, but since it's a prediction, it is only as true as predictions can be. In the future, there will be no more humans. Seems to me that that is beyond a peradventure true, but of course it's a speculation. But I also want to make a second claim, and that is that this is not one of the things we need worry about. And it's really the reasons why we don't have to worry about that if we take the right precautionary measures now. Recent discussions of innovation in science and technology have been characterized, it seems to me, by a general tendency to regard them as causes for concern rather than as opportunities for good. Of course, some are causes for concern, and most are also opportunities for good. People, even scientists, don't tend to develop things they think will be a disaster. But of course, they can be wrong. We need, therefore, to decide as rationally as we can, but also as readily as we can, what we should be worried about and what we should welcome. Of course, we must always be vigilant. Vigilance is not only the price of liberty, but the price of safety. However, a precautionary approach is self-defeating when it prevents or delays innovation which will save or improve lives. We need to remember that we, as individuals, as citizens, both of our nation states and the European community and indeed the world, we need more and better science and innovation so that the ethical imperative of making the world a better place can be realized, including, of course, by better, I mean a safer place. Today I want to talk about some of the things we need to worry about more and some that we can worry about less. Science can be driven either by needs or by curiosity, and often, of course, by a combination of both. Its effective practice requires a substantial degree of openness through both informal and formal communication. The latter is characterized by peer-reviewed publication, which provides some assurance of accuracy and allows the attribution of credit for achievement. Irrespective of motivation, scientific research frequently gives rise to goods and services that are both novel and valuable. Traditionally, science was divided into pure and applied, more recently termed research and development. The idea was that the former is financed from the public or the charitable purse, and as such is able to explore freely, while the latter by investment and is therefore goal-directed. This distinction is now unfashionable for various reasons. One good reason is the undoubted fact that research and development coexist, often even in the same person and in the same lab. Without novel findings from research, there can be no development. Equally, in the course of development, novel ideas and discoveries turn up which do not belong to the goal-oriented process as such. The pace of research is often conditional upon technological process, which is the product of development, for example, in instrumentation. All of this mandates the abandonment of an unnecessary semantic distinction. I mean, we're on the verge now. When my colleague John Sulston started sequencing genes, it was very expensive and very time-consuming. We are on the verge of the first $1,000 human genome. which would have taken months only a few years ago, now takes less than a week. And that cost and that pace will come down. And that's largely due to improvements in instrumentation. However, this sort of pragmatism becomes destructive if it further mandates for financial or social reasons that all research should have a defined purpose. The most important and far-reaching discoveries come about through unfettered exploration, through the exercise of curiosity. And I'll return to the theme of curiosity in a minute, because I want to suggest to you that it is curiosity, perhaps more than any other human attribute, that actually defines us as a species. And because, having now suggested that we might well be defined as the curious species, I want to go on to suggest that our days are numbered, and that that is also probably a good thing. To do so, though, I want to turn to another great philosopher, and this time a great English philosopher of the Renaissance. I refer, of course, to William Shakespeare and to his play, The Tempest. For those of you familiar with the play, and indeed for those unfamiliar, Miranda, young woman brought up in the company of her father, Prospero, a magician, and assorted magical creatures, sees ordinary men for the first time. They happen to have been shipwrecked on the island on which she is. She sees ordinary men for the first time, and she likes what she sees. This is what she says. "Oh, wonder, how many goodly creatures are there here? How beauteous mankind is. Oh, brave new world that has such people in it." Now, since Aldous Huxley, another English literary figure, brave new worlds have had a rather bad press. But Miranda, I believe, is a better guide to the ethics of innovation than was Huxley. Miranda can be seen as celebrating the discovery of her own kind, celebrating humanity. But I think she sees a deeper truth. Remember that the only men that she had encountered up to making this speech, besides her father, were the magical, intangible Ariel and the loathsome and pitiable Caliban. Not much of a choice for a spirited young woman. But when she encounters young, good-looking, and as it happens, Italian men for the first time, she is not so much confirming a species preference, but demonstrating openness to a better world, to a world better than the one she currently inhabits, to a brave new world. Miranda's quotidian world is magical, but she chooses a better, less familiar world instead. The prestige and power of science has sometimes been attributed to the fact that science is just, and I quote from a former tutor of mine, "Science is just magic that works, which is more reliable than magic." That's why we prefer science to magic. Insofar as this is true, the future as well as the past, we may hope, will be truly magical. And it will have all sorts of unprecedented, and again, we may hope, goodly creatures in it. In the future, there will be all kinds of new creatures out there, and it will be our business to ensure that they are all as goodly as they can be. Some will be man-made, and of course I mean to include women in here, but rather than man and woman-made in the rather conventional sexual way, resulting from something more akin to construction than sexual reproduction. They may result from synthetic gametes, or so-called synthetic biology. But however synthetic their creation, they will be real in every important sense. Some other beasts will be interspecies entities, initially probably the resulting from the interspecies embryos that already exist, but eventually mature creatures that run around on the carpet and possibly frighten the horses. Some of you may know that famous remark from Mrs. Patrick Campbell, an actress, who was asked what she thought about homosexuality, which was very much disapproved of in her time, and she said, "Well, it's perfectly all right what people do, in the privacy of their own homes, so long as they don't do it in the street and frighten the horses. I think there were horse-drawn carriages at that time. Other creatures will be mixtures, not of human animals, genes or parts, but perhaps humans with technology implanted. Not like the heart, pacemakers, or prosthetic limbs, which we are familiar with already, but perhaps with tiny nanobots that will dramatically enhance mental powers. In the last couple of years, I've spent some very interesting time on two working parties established by the UK Academy of Medical Sciences, looking first at the ethics and the policy dimensions of creating interspecies embryos, and more recently, our report's just published, looking at the creation of interspecies creatures. It seems to me a rather cruel irony that we humans agonize endlessly about the loss of randomly created species, those species that were created by Darwinian evolution, but we seem to be scared witless of producing new species ourselves, made, so to speak, to measure. I want to suggest to you that it is just as well that all of these new sorts of beings are on the way, because in the future, it is likely that we will have to face the end of humanity as we know it. We, everybody, the sorts of people in this room, will either have died out altogether, killed off by self-created global warming or self-created disease, or we may hope we will have been replaced by our successors, produced either by Darwinian evolution or, as I believe, increasingly more likely, by the successors we have deliberately produced ourselves by what I call enhancement evolution rather than Darwinian evolution. The end of humanity, then, is not, I believe, a cause of concern in itself. Making sure that what replaces us is something better is a huge concern. And remember that we will also have to make sure that our successors have somewhere else to live. We know that the days of our sun are numbered. That was a nice Freudian slip. No nuns in the audience today. The days of our sun are numbered, and when it perishes, so too will the earth. We have to be sure that our successors will have the wit and the technology to find somewhere else in the universe to live, assuming we still survive, or the wit and the technology to construct somewhere else to live. We're talking very far in the future, but I believe in horizon scanning. One of the most dramatic and important of the new technologies that will produce new creatures is synthetic biology. When people talk about synthetic biology and synthetic life, they often have in mind, at least in the popular press, scientists in the lab making creatures out of old socks, coat hangers, and some perhaps vat of bubbling biochemical primeval soup. This, however, is far from likely, or at least far in the future. Synthetic biology is the name now used for a cluster of new technologies in which biomolecular components, natural or synthetic, are newly combined or reorganized in order to create novel genetic and biochemical circuitry, pathways, and ultimately organisms. It may be thought of as a hybrid discipline between science and engineering. Synthetic biology, though, has caught the imagination, not least because it marks the beginnings of what looks like the possibility of manufacturing life forms literally from scratch, and eventually of creating tailor-made creatures in our own image, or in principle, in the image and with the attributes of anything we like, or at least anything we can imagine and engineer. This is heady stuff, and if it works, may give us unprecedented powers, which, like all powers, may be used for good or evil, or simply wasted for lack of use. Many people believe that we humans have been made in the image of God, by a God who presumably likes the way she looks. Is it the hubris of such a prospect, however remote, that makes the possibility of humans doing the same so daunting and dramatic? Hubris may be an unpleasant personal trait, possibly even a defect of character, but it is hardly a decisive moral argument. However, I think it is not hubris to believe that we can do good and to try to do it. Is synthetic biology one of the things we should be worried about? How should we begin to address such a question? A deep question, and one I've discussed at much more length elsewhere, but I'll raise it here. A deep question, and one that needs far more informed public discussion, is the question of what role humanity, species membership, in short, the descriptive sense of being human, plays in the evaluative sense of that term. When we identify humanity not simply with species membership, being human, but with being a moral being, we may be claiming one of two very different things. The first is that we humans, members of the species Homo sapiens sapiens, are characterized by, among other qualities, moral agency, and other important features like the capacity for sympathy, empathy, and creativity, and curiosity, as I've indicated. But the second thing we might mean is that the possession of these qualities is essentially human, possessed by us only because we are the species that we are. This second sense implies that our humanity, in the moral sense, is not simply species typical, but species essential, requiring being human in the biological or genetic sense as a necessary condition. There is, it seems to me, not only a danger, but there is a long-established and deeply ingrained habit of identifying properties or qualities that are contingently possessed by human beings as not only necessarily possessed by our kind, but moreover necessarily not possessed by other kinds. Kinds of individuals other than humans of whatsoever nature who possess the characteristics that enable them not only to have a life, but to be aware that they have a life, have at least since the 17th century been termed persons to distinguish them from human beings. And I want to suggest to you that so long as persons continue to exist, we don't have to worry about whether the persons that exist are human or not. Let me turn aside to, there's a president of a university here, wonderful. One of the things I usually say in defense of people like me who are philosophers and who don't run labs and don't do anything useful really in life is that we do have an abiding virtue, and it's that we're jolly cheap to employ. We don't need labs, we don't need equipment. But what we do is occasionally we do thought experiments, and I want to offer you a thought experiment, not one of my own, unfortunately, because it's a jolly good one. One I owe to Richard Dawkins in a brilliant essay called Gaps in the Mind. Anybody read it? Wonderful essay. Will it hurt if I go away from the microphone? Are you recording this? Shall I shout loud? I need to move about, if I may. Dawkins asks us to imagine a contemporary human woman standing on the coast of Africa. Here's the coast of Africa. There's the sea, facing north towards Europe. And in her right hand, she's holding the hand of her mother. And her mother, in her right hand, is holding the hand of her mother, and so on in a human chain, stretching at right angles to the sea across the continent of Africa. Each woman takes up about a meter of space, a bit over a yard of space, with her hands outstretched, holding her mother and her mother. And so on back in a human chain, to our common ape ancestor about 7.5 million years ago. Now that human chain takes a long time chronologically to get back to our ape ancestor, but it's only about 300 miles. Only 300 miles, you hardly notice it on a big atlas of the world across the continent of Africa. And there is our common ape ancestor, and in her right hand, she's holding the hand of her daughter, and so on in another human chain back to the coast. So at the end of the thought experiment, we have a contemporary human woman, the one we started with, facing the granddaughter of our common ancestor, who is a contemporary chimpanzee. Now, what I find instructive about that story, well, there are many things that are instructive about it, and I'm not suggesting that we are descended from chimpanzees. No, that would be wrong. We're not. But we and chimpanzees are descended from a common ancestor. And it is an accident of evolution that apes that we could have mated with have died out. So it's an accident of evolution that we constitute a species in the biological sense of being able to reproduce with one another sexually, but not with other apes. But now, of course, we have the technology. We don't need to be able to reproduce, so to speak, sexually with apes, because we have the technology to do it without that particular sort of intervention. What would we think? Suppose our common ape ancestors had all got together on the plains of Africa and said, simian nature, jolly good thing, absolutely perfect. I don't think we should go in for this enhancement at all. We should just keep ourselves exactly as we are and make sure that we don't evolve into something different. Life's good here. Well, I'm jolly glad that our ape ancestors didn't get together and make that resolution and perhaps pass it through the United Nations and have universal declarations of simian rights, which Judith would have upheld to the letter and made sure that nobody breached. I'm glad because we are passing what I hope is a reasonably agreeable afternoon talking to each other, which we wouldn't have been able to do had our simian ancestors laid a particular law down. But I think we have enhanced reasons not to make those sorts of decisions about further evolutionary change. We need it, or we will need it. In another paper which I mentioned but do not recommend, I wrote a paper called Taking the Human Out of Human Rights, which takes these ideas a bit further. It seems to me that human rights is the wrong thing to think about, useful as it is. We should think about the rights of persons. It's not just a species thing, even though we like to think that it is. Unprecedented powers are always awesome. And this is what I'm suggesting that we might wish to create, need to create for ourselves. When the nuclear age dawned on the 6th of August, 1945, it began to dawn on people that for the first time, we humans had the power not only to kill many others, but to kill all others, themselves included, everyone and every living thing. And as fears of the possibility of a nuclear war, utilizing a policy of mutually assured destruction grew, the possibility of a resulting nuclear winter began to gain credence. A winter which not only no humans, but possibly no living creatures at all, could or would survive. For the first time, humans, man, had within his hands and her hands, though as it happens, it was only men in those days who had their fingers on the trigger, so to speak, the power to destroy the world. This power has reemerged as an accidental byproduct of energy use and consequent climate change. Bertrand Russell, who did more than most to alert humankind to the dangers of nuclear power, wondered what we humans could plead on our own behalf as to why we didn't deserve to suffer the destructive possibilities which we had ourselves created. He imagines a conversation with God, and being very politically correct, Russell imagines that the God he's having the conversation with is Osiris, rather than one of the more popular contemporary deities. If I were the pleader, he said to Osiris, for the continuation of the human race, I should say, O just and inexorable judge, the indictment of my species is all too well deserved, and never more so than in the present day. But we are not all guilty, and few of us are without better potentialities than those that our circumstances have developed. Great men have shown us that it is within human power to create a world of shining beauty and transcendent glory. Perhaps our prayer will be heard. In any case, it is because of such possibilities, which so far as we know exist only for man, that our species is worth preserving. Now, Russell, as I said, was concerned with a nuclear catastrophe that might destroy all life. He was pleading for the survival of the human species, but not a survival that would preserve it with all its faults and follies. but a survival that would enable the realization of, quote, better potentialities. At the conclusion of these remarks, which come from his little pamphlet published in 1961 called Has Man a Future, he says this: man has potentialities of greatness and splendor realized as yet partially, but showing what life might be in a freer and happier world. If man will allow himself to grow to his full stature, what he may achieve is beyond our present capacity to imagine. Poverty, illness, and loneliness could become rare misfortunes. And with the progress of evolution, what is now the shining genius of an eminent few might become a common possession of the many. All this is possible, indeed probable, in the thousands of centuries that lie before us. Now, Russell might initially be taken to be saying that it is the survival of humans as we know them that has value. But for him, what mattered was the preservation and expansion of what is good about humans. I think we too have to prioritize improvements that are possible on humans over simply preserving the species in its present form. The desire to better ourselves and make ourselves better is part of the curiosity and the need that drives science. One of the oldest and most valuable of the things that characterize persons. The example of an enhancing technology that I've been highlighting in this talk is synthetic biology. But consider another example of a human enhancement, one that we're all benefiting from even as I speak, everybody in this room. It's one of my favorite examples, and it is, of course, synthetic sunshine. We are bathed in this room now in synthetic sunshine. Before synthetic sunshine, we humans and our ancestors had to go to sleep when it got dark and to get up and work and play when the sun came up. But with the advent of synthetic sunshine, work and play could continue through the hours of darkness, and our lives were transformed. And synthetic sunshine, then as now, contains many of the undesirable features that are pointed to for many forms of human enhancement. It was inegalitarian because it was expensive. Firelight, candlelight, lamplight was expensive and available only to elites. There was a wonderful expression in English, which I don't know if it exists in Hungarian, but I discovered on chatting to some people, and I flew here from Italy. They have the same expression in Italian. It is that the game isn't worth the candle. In the old days, to play dice or cards, you had to light a candle. And if it was going to be a bad game, it wasn't worth paying for the light that would light the game. So if the game isn't worth a candle, and that showed that only those who could afford candles as much as they wanted could play all the time. So one of the things that is often predicated about enhancements is that they lead to unfairness and injustice is regrettably true, but it seems to me that the right thing to do about injustice is to increase supply, not to play a rather dog-in-the-manger role and say, if everybody can't have it, nobody's going to have it. And while that might seem trivial if we're thinking about candles and games of dice, it's not trivial when we think, for example, about new life-saving drugs, vaccines, adequate supply of donor organs. The counsel of a decent person is surely not to say we won't do any organ transplants until there's enough for all. We do as many as we can and try our damnedest to increase the supply by various strategies. The solution to unfair working conditions, for example, is establishing fair working hours and the provision of public expensive necessary, in the case of synthetic sunshine, of sources of light, not banning candles. I won't say anything more about this at the moment, but this raises very interesting questions about another contemporary device that puts limits on the process of science development and innovation, which ends up in products, and that is the system of intellectual property law that we have. I won't go into that, but I think there's very good evidence that patents in particular are having a dampening effect on the process of science. And I will offer you one other example, interestingly, that comes from sunshine. Jonas Salk, who was one of the developers of the polio vaccine, was asked why he had never tried to patent it. And he looked astonished and said, "Would you patent the sun?" It was obviously of such benefit that it would be unethical to attempt to patent it. And there are many things of which that is also true. I'm winding up now, and I hope you will have thought of lots of objections to the general tenor of my talk. The most urgent and worrying ethical problems surrounding the use of new technologies, including synthetic biology, are not the dangers of pursuing such research and the innovation that may result. Such dangers attend all research of any kind, of whatever nature, and they must always be resolved, if they're resolvable, by the best estimation of risk as against benefit. The dangers that I believe have consistently been underestimated are the dangers of not pursuing such research, because a host of feeble and often incoherent objections and objectors have placed themselves in the path of progress towards a better future for ourselves and indeed our planet. The problem is turning our back on these possibilities, perhaps because, in the words of, sorry, I choose English literary figures, but it's the language that I'm most familiar with, in T.S. Eliot's wonderful words, because we do not dare disturb the universe. I think we need to think about disturbing the universe a bit more. Throughout what I've said today, I've focused on the job of science to do good, if you like, its moral mission to do good. That's what it's, if not therefore, at least that's what justifies it. But in order to do good, we have to pursue what is sometimes called curiosity-based science. When we target it, we cut ourselves off from all sorts of things that might be discovered. Hugely significant as the humanitarian role for science is, and perceived by many to be, there is in fact another even more important, and it is related to the curiosity that I referred to at the start of this talk, but it has a deeper, much deeper, I believe, significance. Science is a cultural driver in its own right. Indeed, one could say that it is the major cultural driver, certainly over the last few hundred years, probably even longer. This is not to attribute any new character to science, simply to make the observation that our perception of the human condition and of the universe around us is constantly challenged and reshaped by the findings of science. Furthermore, without our continuous exploration, by whatever methods, life would be dull indeed, possibly even have no meaning at all. And science has proved to be a powerful method of exploration for a very long time. The scientific process is familiar to everyone and practiced by all, whether they name it as such or not. Broadly defined, I want to suggest to you that science is the chief purpose of humanity, or rather, of persons. Whatever kind of persons there may be in the future, we would want them as our rightful descendants, both to be moral beings and to possess the innate scientific curiosity that is what drives us human persons today. And if I may, I will end with one more anecdote. Coming, as I did, literally yesterday from Italy, you'll all be familiar with the wonderful piece of partly Italian science, which has discovered that it's possible that neutrinos travel faster than light. This is certainly, if it proves repeatable and true, going to challenge a whole set of worldviews and upset them. But it also has illustrated another important need, which I am sure that this university and many others are devoted to, and that is improving, hopefully, not only the public understanding of science and technology and cultural drivers, but indeed the politicians' understanding of these, because you may know that I think it was the Italian Minister for Science got on television, and the result of this, and completely out of her hat, briefed by her civil servants, announced that she was particularly proud of the Italians' contribution to this piece of research, because the Italian government had put up a very large sum of money, £45 million, to help build the tunnel through which the neutrinos had been challenged from CERN near Geneva to under the Gran Sasso, which is a mountain range in the north of Italy, to where the instruments were measuring the speed of the neutrinos. Most of you, I'm sure, will know that, of course, neutrinos don't need a tunnel because they pass through absolutely anything without any resistance whatsoever. But this minister was very quick to claim credit not only for the science, but for the building of the tunnel, which had enabled the science to take place. Thank you very much.
Observed your speech, and I think that it's this is the time for the debate now, and in which everyone is invited to give questions or comments, and I think also challenges are welcome.
Absolutely.
Before doing that, let me introduce some people in the audience, and I should have done it perhaps even in the introduction. And I have to express my special gratitude to all who made possible our work of this multidisciplinary work within for Center on Ethics and Law in Biomedicine, CELA. And I also would like to thank to my courses colleagues who worked in this very exciting and not always easy journey to enter into this interdisciplinary field, and I'm doing this introduction because I'm sure that they would like to have some comments and questions to the lecture. First of all, my colleague Enrico Demi, who is a philosopher and anthropologist, also a member of CELA, Petra Black, who is a lawyer, Violetta Besirevic, Josef Kovac, who is professor at the Medical School of Shota, Budapest, Peter Kaku, also bioethicist from the University of Debrecen, and unfortunately Martin Bor, who cannot be here, who is also an expert on intellectual property law, and also Jurij Kovac, and also have several previous members of CELAB also being here in the audience. So I think that one of the major points, maybe before people will ask questions about, do you see that these contemporary changes which you have described, and we should not really worry about of the enhancement as such, but we very much have to think about of whether this metamorphosis from persons to humans and human beings, whether we should think about what is the core element of enhancement. And it's interesting because in legal documents, some of the contemporary, and you cited some human rights instruments, they actually acknowledge the change, and I think to make the situation worse or at least contestable, replacing the term person to human being. And human beings are entitled to new types of rights. Just let me refer to Oviedo Convention, which is one of the most widely known documents in this region, and which is often mentioned as the Bioethics Convention. And it's already made this change. And it goes a little bit against of the argument you presented when you said that we should not worry about this element of human, but the core element of the enhancement we should really worry about is the personal qualities and facilities, and that goes against a little bit of the present perceptions of human rights. And my explanations for that, that many of the contemporary legal instruments jump too quickly to the conclusion, and they wanted to provide a good service for science to change the language of law. Of course, there is another interesting parallel debate which is happening since the 50s in UNESCO to erase the race from several documents. It's following a slightly different logic. But if we have to worry about something, I don't know whether we have to something at all, that what should inform us about these worries? Many people feel that we should use, and also use a lot of inspiration from literature and art, and also the society, the politicians raise different types of concerns. What should inform our worries? And that's one question. And the other thing is that how would you see the legal changes, which goes a little bit of a different directions, as you've seen, could constitute some problems with enhancement?
That is a fiercely complex question. I can only give a fiercely simplistic answer to it. Just as we've seen a transition, I mean, people used to talk about the rights of man, not human rights at all. They talked about the rights of man. And for very good reasons, that got modified into human rights. And I'm suggesting that that modification has not gone far enough. And it's rather become solidified into human rights, which have become very species-oriented.
And even recently, human being, not even human rights, but human rights.
Well, human being, of course, and a lot of the, if you like, the jurisprudence around this is on when a human is a being protected in this way, so where their embryos count, in other words, whether indeed gametes are protected, and now we know we can reprogram skin cells into both eggs and sperm, probably into embryos as well. There's such a lot of human potential in being that I think it's going to be impossible to cling to these sorts of categories. But there is another problem which would take us, I can't do justice to this now, and any political philosophers in the audience will start acutely fidgeting at this point, but it depends how one understands rights. Now, it seems to me, and you may want to challenge this as well as an eminent human rights lawyer, that in human rights talk, whether it's jurisprudential talk or indeed more popular talk, rights tend to function as the premise of an argument. These rights exist, therefore certain things follow. Now, I think a better way to think about rights is that they should not function as the premise of an argument, but rather as the conclusions to an argument. That you first have to decide what entitlements or interests require protection. You have then to have produce an argument about what degree of protection those interests need. And then it would follow from that rather complicated dialogue as to what rights individuals have. And I think if and when we do go through those, and a lot of political philosophers and moral philosophers, of course, do precisely do that, we will find out that human rights, as currently understood, apply by no means to the generality of human beings. They apply to some subclasses of human beings. And for the same sorts of reasons, they will probably apply to other sorts of creatures as well. But we have to have that long discussion about shifting. And it's not only, one other thing I would like to say. I was brought up in the so-called linguistic tradition of philosophy, which was dominant in Oxford in the 50s and into the 60s and 70s, which dealt with analysing concepts. And a lot of the sorts of philosophical discussions that were had in the rather sterile days of my graduate student life were as to whether people were using terms correctly. I think those arguments are always sterile, and that you cannot deprive somebody of the vocabulary with which they are comfortable. And so many people and so many institutions are comfortable with rights talk that we have to keep that. It's no good somebody like me coming and saying, we don't want to talk about rights talk, we should reanalyze those interests and something else. That's not going to work. So we actually have to think, we have to keep the vocabulary that people are comfortable with, but find a way of reinterpreting it.
Just the last point. I think that my point was that the law was much more receptive to these changes which you have highlighted in your presentation than I actually would think about. For instance, a very recent document, some recommendation of Council of Europe speaking on human rights in a molecular level. And they use the same terminology, discrimination, privacy, when they actually deal with molecules of human beings. So they already made this shift to a kind of biological interpretations of humans, and that's an interesting tendency, and may not correspond with those criticisms that the society is too much worried about, because on the other hand, it created a lot of new sources of rights responding to the new technologies. I think that it's really the point to give a floor to the audience for questions and comments, not necessarily following the discourse and discussion on rights, but something else. And I would like also to ask another help from the center, George Tudor-Florea, who was kind to help us also in assisting in the debate, who is also of a PhD fellow of the center. And if someone would indicate of any question, he can go and help with the microphone to raise questions. Yes, please.
It's on. Thank you. So my question is, there are species of wild dogs, that is, animals that were never domesticated, wild dogs were, and so they stood feral and they're adapted to wildlife condition. Now, if those species died out, I would be sad, not because I value species, not because I think species are sacred, but because those species have very precious properties. They're adapted to the wildlife, and dogs are not. Dogs are adapted to man-made environments. They're adapted to artificial and expensive conditions that, as you said, might disappear someday. So that's the reason why I think that wild dogs are precious and they shouldn't die. Now, I think that if humans died and were replaced by a new species of humans that is adapted to an expensive, highly complex infrastructure that's not likely to last, I would be sad too. So what do you think?
I think I would be sad if you were sad. But that's because I have moral concern for you, not because it would actually be what would worry you would actually, I think, be objectively speaking, worrying. There are lots of things that we value for reasons that are good to us. Many people would be very sad if the Parthenon was destroyed. Many people will be, you know, these are inanimate things, if paintings were lost from a gallery and so forth, because they enrich our lives, and those who care about them, they enrich their lives greatly. But of course, we can produce more of these things, and indeed, it's not, while it is always a tragedy if a human being dies, it is not always a disaster, because more are produced. So, just as we have to, so to speak, accommodate ourselves to the sadness of losing our parents and often tragically our children as well, and ourselves, and nothing would be more tragic to me than losing myself, I promise you, I would grieve greatly. Nonetheless, what matters more than that, it seems to me, is that we are replaceable. Now, just one other thing. I'm not suggesting that it is not a bad thing when biodiversity is reduced. But what I'm suggesting is actually that the very same reasons that make it bad to reduce biodiversity by loss make it good to increase biodiversity by creation.
May I very shortly reply? My point was not about biodiversity as such. I really don't mind if species disappear.
Just this one. Just the dogs.
Species that are highly dependent on an expensive and fragile infrastructure are not a good bet in evolution. We don't want to rely only on them. We want to rely on species that are adapted to less expensive, less complicated infrastructures. That was not my point about diversity.
Well, what we might need, let me put you another possibility, that if we really value these particular wild dogs, and their habitat is threatened, what we might have to do is to genetically engineer them to be able to tolerate a disappearing habitat more effectively, and that would be by creating a slightly different species of wild dog, a way of keeping them.
Thank you. theory of evolution, you seem to provide a picture where there is embetterment. We are doing better because we are a more complex species of ape. And and this is not the case. In fact, the measure of what is better and what is not is far from obvious. And you seem to continue on that metaphor when you talk about enhancement. So who is to judge what is an enhancement and what is not an enhancement? As far as I understood, you would like to rely on what people want to do, what they will, if they think that it is better for them, if they think that they are happier with, I don't know, more brain. Then if we can engineer someone with more brain, let's engineer someone with more brain. But it is not obvious that having more brain is better. Who knows what is better for us?
Well, me, obviously. You asked two questions there, which are related but not the same. One is the who decides question. I'll come to that in a minute. But let's deal with the... not the who decides question, but are they right when they decide? In other words, how do we tell what's better and what's worse? Well, we have to say in what way, if X should happen, it would be worse, and in what way it would be better. And actually, we're jolly good at doing that because we have a very keen sense of self-preservation. Of course, there are cloudy areas. But I want to offer you a test, which works for me, but I'm sure it won't work for you, because... but this is what it is. There is a condition. It doesn't matter what that condition is, okay? That a patient unconscious is admitted to the emergency room of a hospital in that condition. And that condition is reversible. You can't consult the patient because he's unconscious. So somebody and it has to be done now, or the condition will worsen and it will be permanent damage rather than temporary damage. Somebody has to make a decision as to whether it's in that patient's interest that this be reversed or not. Now, of course, there's no infallible way of doing that. But actually, I'm pretty confident that there will be a vast consensus on almost all of the conditions that we might invent. From something relatively trivial, but still significant to the person. Example I like to use is the loss of the last segment of my little finger on my right hand. My life would be perfectly tolerable if I lost that segment permanently. But if I'm admitted to the emergency room with that segment lying on the cushion of the ambulance stretcher by my side, I expect somebody to sew it back on. Why? Because I expect them to make the sensible judgment that even though it's a trivial harm, it would be better if I didn't have to suffer that harm. And I'm confident that there would be a vast range of consensus. Now, that doesn't mean there would be total consensus. And it may be over certain things, we would never get agreement. Where that is true, then we shouldn't do them. Possibly. I mean, that might be one solution to your question. Now, I just wanted to say the who decides question, because that's the how do you know whether what's deciding is right or wrong. Well, I'm a Democrat, and I hope you are too. And in democracies, with all their, I mean, as you know, God, I'm always quoting English people. It's so embarrassing when you go elsewhere in the world. And nobody's heard of any of these Englishmen. But Winston Churchill was very famous for saying, democracy is the worst conceivable form of government except for all the others. Now, in a democracy, the answer to the who decides question is always the same. It's the democratic process, whatever that process is. We have to decide collectively after debate and discussion of the sort that we're having in this room what it would be right to implement. And so that's the who decides question. And it's always the same answer, it's all of us.
If you don't mind, I would like to come back on one point. You said that we are pretty good in deciding whether democratically or not. And it is a rejoinder to the previous question. I think that we are probably very bad at deciding. One reason is that our choices will be dependent on very unstable environments. So for instance, at the moment, it seems to be very good to have a high IQ. But we don't know what a high IQ is. So people, if you democratically ask them, do you want to have a higher IQ? They would say, yes, 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 we want to have a higher IQ. But it may be completely unadaptive to have a higher IQ. Not only that, it is also possible that the choices that we will make will be in terms of costly signal. You know, costly signal, it's the fact that you want to impress, so for instance, you want to impress the other. And costly signals are good for the individual, but they are bad for the population. So if you ask individuals, then they will lead in ways that will probably be worse for the population as a whole.
I don't think I disagree, and the answer is fortunately still the same, because we have that's the who decides question, and unfortunately we are saddled with this system which is absolutely awful except for all the others, that we're saddled with a system that aggregates individual choices in through the democratic process, and so we're already in the situation where those costly decisions are made and endorsed by the systems that we operate. Now, what you have to do is to come up with an alternative, which is not tyranny, which would do a better job.
Actually, my question is a follow-up of the discussion. I wanted to ask, what do you think about the role of deliberative governance in science and innovation process? Because maybe we all can agree that making the world a better place is a shared idea, but this could mean very different things for different people. And some people argue that how long you can meaningfully involve the general public and society in complex decisions about the direction of science when things getting very complicated even for scientists themselves. And maybe another part of this question, how do you see the role of bioethics, which is an important discourse of shaping knowledge today?
Well, I mean, I'm not an expert on all of the fields that would be required to answer your question. But linking with the question I was just asked about the relevance of intelligence, I tend to have the prejudice that we are better able to do the deliberative part of deliberative governance with more intelligence rather than less and more knowledge rather than less, which speaks for both cognitive enhancement of a dramatic, possibly chemical sort, and cognitive enhancement of the more normal and familiar sort, namely education. I mean, we actually do have pretty good cognitive enhancement strategies already, and that's why we put children through compulsory education, whether they like it or not, and whether their parents like it or not, because we think that a certain level of whatever it is that education delivers, including more uniform behaviour, is a good thing. We may be wrong about that. So I think we need more deliberation. We need more politicians who don't imagine, because they think it'll be popular, that their government might have spent some imaginary money on an imaginary tunnel. That we certainly don't want. But that's not a very good answer to your question, because that's your field, not mine, fortunately for me.
Thank you very much for the interesting presentation. First of all, I have two questions, and one builds on top of the second one. You mentioned that in research and development, a lot of things are goal-oriented. So in what it is that you do, what is the goal? Is it to experiment around with things and let's see what comes out of it, just like we have done with all the other minerals and materials and everything else till now? And the second question is, you talked about man and woman made things that can at the end cause us to come to an end, right? How confident are you that this will not be it? You know, because this could be we have all these horror movies and everything is just in science fiction level right now. But how is it a territory they would like to cross? You know, are we fully confident in our science, in our abilities, that we will not make a mistake that will be costly for the rest of us? What if we develop a virus or something that does not appear in human genetics, but could appear in this kind of genetics? Thank you.
Well, to one, just because it's easier, and with any luck, I'll take so long to answer the easy one that I won't even remember or get to the difficult question, which was the early one. Well, we do have strategies to cope with quite a lot of what the danger. And that is, one thing is, for whatever reason, we don't want to do everything at once. So the last thing any sane person would do would be introduce a virus which would infect the world, even for a good outcome. There was a terrible accident at Northwood Park Hospital in the UK a few years ago where criminal negligence in the conduct of the trial led to 8 patients being given a very risky procedure simultaneously rather than sequentially. So that all 8 were damaged rather than doing it one at a time and seeing what happens. So we do have strategies, and we know that it's negligent when those very obvious protocols are not operated. Fortunately, most of the interventions that would operate at a population level, other than viruses or bacteria, take ages and ages. I mean, if you, for example, if you were using a genetic intervention or a reproductive intervention, it would be generations and generations before it could become universal. And that would give us plenty of time to see actually whether it was doing the job or not. So I'm less pessimistic about the dangers. We're not going to do it all at once, and we shouldn't do it all at once. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't do a bit of suck it and see, and hope for the best. But not hope for the best in the sense of not knowing what the outcome of the intervention would be, but not knowing the long-term effects. We usually know what the short-term effects were. If we didn't, then it would be criminal to do it at all. But because we won't know the long-term effects, that's why we try not to introduce things all at once. There are certain things though that are so popular, like mobile phones, that they've been introduced very rapidly. And if there is an adverse long-term effect, we're all in deep trouble. Now, what was the first question, which I've conveniently forgotten?
The first question was about the gold. Are you doing it to just see what's out there?
No, of course not. No, there is. Do you know Ali G, the comedian? Of course you do. Well, Ali G's mate Dave had a very good concept of science. He put the cat in the microwave to see what would happen. Well, that's not science. You don't just do something to see what would happen. You have to have a hypothesis. You have to know pretty certainly what you want to happen. You have to rationally consider whether this is a good way to get that to happen. So no, nobody, it ain't scientific if you just do it to see what would happen. And Ali's mate Dave is, I rashly said that we're all scientists to a certain degree. I withdraw that. I exempt Ali G's mate Dave and the cat.
I also have 2 questions. First is regarding...
Just as well, I can count up to 2, but no further.
That was an instruction. So the first question is regarding indoctrination and active placebo, that in the new book of Ivan Kish, the Emperor's New Drug, he found evidences that it seems that many antidepressants, the efficiency of many antidepressants has a active placebo, has major role of active placebo. And also in psychotherapies, we know that indoctrination and suggestion has a great role. And the question regarding to that, is evidence-based medicine, which is kind of always measuring pharmacon with an active placebo, can cope with this new kind of doubts and new kind of results about active placebo? So can science really explore the indoctrination and the active placebo problem? This is the first question. The second question is neuromania. This is Raymond Tallis professor and others debating on that hard science results many times are reframed in very, very soft and very, very incoherent logical frames, and soft scientists like sociology and philosophy and all the others attack neurologists that, hey, these, your hard results put in a very loose context. But because behind of hard science there is also an ideological structure, this war is still going on and seems no end. So what's your point on megalomania? That's my second question.
Right. Well, to deal with the second one first, and rather superficially, as I seem to be dealing with most of the questions, we need Ray Talis to deal with, and he's a good mate of mine, so whatever he's, I believe in the argument from authority. I think he's a very sound man, so whatever he says is absolutely right on this issue. No, but seriously, the answer is in his book, Aping Mankind, and it's the right answer. We just need more people to take notice of Ray Talis on that point, and think about those arguments. In a way, your other question was the same as the one I just tried to deal with. It is, what about the unforeseen effects of... It's pretty much that, is it not? Insofar as it's that, you said, hastening on, insofar as it's about unforeseen effects, we have to make, do we not, some estimation of how bad they're likely to be as against how bad it will be if we forego the also known good effects of using that intervention, whatever it is. And that may be a very difficult calculation to make, but it's not clear to me that that's just to say that certain things are, it is unclear how good or how bad they're likely to be in the long run. And I don't know, I'm no better at dealing with that than anybody, but there's no way out of that. It's rather like a clean hands problem in ethics. There's no way of keeping your hands completely spotless. You have to decide which of the rather messy things that confront you is the best, all things considered, as you now understand them. And that's just, it seems to me, that is the human condition, to make those decisions. But there's no way of foolproofing those decisions, it seems to me. So we may be wrong, yeah? And it's bad if we are. So we have to have more intelligence and more education, and I hope that we're wrong less often. But you may disagree.
I would like to have a question first. Thank you very much for this very interesting lecture. And I have read your book about enhancing evolution. And let me ask a little bit conceptual hair splitting. Because is there such a thing? Can we enhance evolution? Evolution is a kind of natural law, like gravitation, for instance. And I understand that we can use gravitation for some purposes, but can we change gravitation? Can we enhance gravitation? And in the same manner, of course, we can speed up evolution, but evolution is a natural law. And natural selection is not done only by nature, it is done every day, even within a society. Society unconsciously does a kind of natural selection, which is belonging to evolution. And there was a question, who decides? And you said that, of course, the democratic process decides, and I absolutely agree, the democratic process decides in the short term. But in the long term, evolution decides, and even democratic process can be, democratic process, as we see it, is not suitable for solving a lot of environmental questions, and this is the problem, that it can decide only for short term, not for 100 years, and evolution is thinking in the time frame of thousands of years. So my question is that can we enhance evolution?
It depends what one means by evolution. I mean, I'm sorry, that's a terrible philosopher's answer. But look, if one takes... I'm going to say something very simplistic about one version of it, evolution. I mean, you get a... Evolution partially works because you get a mutation which proves to be adaptive, basically. And it may not prove to be adaptive for a very long time. Now, and that's completely random, because nobody engineered that mutation. It just happened, and those creatures with that mutation survived better than those that didn't, and maybe grew extra bits from that mutation and so on. Enhancing evolution is just instead of waiting for random mutations, is trying to make a decision about what it would be useful, what changes it might be useful, adapted to make. But of course, that involves making predictions about how the environment is going to change. And also, of course, taking steps to ensure that it does or doesn't change in that way, which is what we're able to do now. So unlike lots of evolutionary processes that have happened hitherto, we are now in a position to not only influence the creature through engineering what might have been, in evolutionary terms, a mutation, but in also engineering the environment to accommodate that. So we're doing at least two sorts of things, lots of others as well. It seems to me that at the moment we've been doing that rather negligently, not really thinking about how we're changing the environment, not thinking about global warming, not thinking about the effects of the internal combustion engine, not thinking about all sorts of things. And it seems to me we now have to start thinking about all of those things, and that whole process of trying to decide what will be good for us and good for the planet, and then trying to implement it. Because the alternatives seems to me are not likely to be better, and probably likely to be worse. But of course we could get all of that wrong. But nature could get it wrong as well. Nature could mean that no sentient, self-conscious beings would survive more than a few hundred years, and that would be fine for whatever did survive, but it wouldn't be fine for us, or for our hopes and fears, or for the existence of hopes and fears, because it is only creatures that can envisage the future that can have hopes. So that's the sort of creature we're interested in hanging on to, it seems to me. But that would require a whole other argument to develop that mind.
I think Howard and Gillett.
Howard has to declare an interest. We were students together.
I also edited a book with Ray Tallis.
And you're in very good company twice over.
Topical proposals, for example, the ultimate replacement of human beings by some other kind of person, resembles plans that eugenicists had in the early part of the 20th century. And the great difficulty with those plans is trying to persuade the people of a kind who are going to be replaced not to want to reproduce themselves in quantity. Now, H.G. Wells, in Anticipation, had certain views about that. But it usually seems to involve either persuading people not to reproduce themselves, which is a very difficult business if you're talking about the great mass of ordinary humanity, or stopping them from reproducing themselves, either by killing them or doing other dramatic things to them. How, without resorting to those matters, which those kind of things, which raise problems of all kinds, would you hope to sell, so to speak, to the creatures that would normally want to replicate their own kinds, the prospect of being replaced by something else?
Well, firstly, there is a vast, as it were, category difference between trying to determine what sorts of creatures will exist in the future by killing a very large number of present people out of hand or stopping them reproduce, and by having various sorts of population policies. I don't think anything that I'm suggesting is anything in principle recommending that people don't produce, let us say, more than 1.5 children. That will be one strategy. You have to persuade people that they have to limit their reproduction, and we do that. But my program, not that I have a program, but if I had a program, my program would not require that everybody in the future be modified in a particular way, or indeed that most people would. All that is needed is enough to produce the technology that will be necessary to enable survival for everybody else. We don't have to wipe out types of people. We just have to ensure that there are enough people who will be able to develop the technology to make the changes that can keep the whole lot going. And that's exactly what we do in a welfare state. Enough people have to produce both the resources and the science to distribute. It doesn't require wiping out the needy. We don't need a health service that selectively kills off or allows people to die who are diseased or who are likely to reproduce people with disease. What we need is enough development of treatments and enough wealth to care for those people. So that's all that my program, insofar as it is a program, requires. It doesn't require anything like eugenics.
You're going to have a higher class of person, manufactured as well as us in the same
way. We already have that. You are a higher class of person I've known ever since I first set eyes on you. And of course,
persuaded.
Well, it's a real pity that I will now somehow interrupt this course of discussion, but being the lawyer, I would like to ask you something more practical.
Oh, no.
Sorry. You said that if we cannot agree on certain things, we should do these things. What about something like that? What about people who are suffering because we cannot agree? For example, terminally ill persons. Who are dying and who want to be helped in dying, but we cannot agree whether euthanasia, for example, assisted suicide, is good or a bad thing. What would be your reaction to this?
Well, we have to have the argument, but we don't, depending on the principles we adopt, we don't have to have the agreement. I mean, where I think, if you like, that libertarianism scores over all of the other doctrines is that if you want to die and I don't have to die. But I don't have to impose my solution on you. So the way of getting most people what they want is to allow them to disagree, but allowing them to disagree means that we don't have one policy, that we actually allow people to practice their religion, which is different from mine, and we allow people to practice their euthanasia, which I don't want, or whatever it happens to be. So what we do have to do, though, of course, is to persuade people that a certain minimum of liberty is requisite in a civil society that deserves the name civil. Now that isn't easy, but it's easier than getting everybody to agree.
Maybe I'll ask a question by Thomas.
Yeah, thanks for a truly great lecture, because there's so many things, questions I could ask, and I can't. I want you to just speculate for me. The dilemma I have is I actually do believe exactly your opening premise is totally correct. I mean, I come from a university, not a European university, in a medical school where people aren't playing these games with stem cells. I have a very good friend who's linking up, and it's not just even forms of life, it's different chemical elements. He's playing with the carbon-based light and silicon-based light, and having neurons speak to silicon cells and vice versa. So this future you've outlined is happening. But where I get my sense of unease is, I don't get the sense we have the institutional arrangements or structures that allow the conversations that have to require to happen. You've mentioned, and it's a query that philosophers have to be involved, we have to seriously think about what kind of principles are attached to personhood as opposed to being human, if we're going to have a dialogue. I'm more concerned with the dialogic element here. Because my experience of this has been that it's not individuals that are advancing this future you've described. It's sort of it's elements of the species. I mean, it seems to be, you're right, we're curiosity-driven species. It's 1,000 scientists who are working independently but together somehow who are doing this. So the question then becomes, is there a parliament or a democracy of scientific ideas that seems to be happening? But I don't get the sense of a parliament or democracy of ideas about the social and the ethical implications of this. So do you have any thoughts of how we can organize the discourse? And this is part of it. Having venues like this, but this is like, what, Friday afternoon in Budapest with like 70 people.
No better place to be on earth.
I agree. But when I leave here, I'll be worried about where I'm going to eat and stuff. Yeah. Tomorrow I'll be worried about where I buy my groceries. So how do we make this happen, is what, I guess my question.
You make a very good point. And I don't know how we make it happen, but I'll give you one model for that in a moment. But I think we're a lot further back than that, or I'm a lot further back than that. I'm the... let's get this on the agenda a bit, stage. And the agenda is starting on a Friday afternoon in Budapest and in and Lucca in Tuscany, where I've just come from, and various other places, and not me, but everybody, talking about thinking about these things and reacting badly or well to the sorts of things that might happen. You're way ahead of this in terms of the institutional structures. Now, there are some models to think about this. They're not ideal ones. This is where we need, of course, the lawyers and other things. But I think one model, which, while not successful totally, or even as much as I would like,
is the UK model for the for the regulation of embryology. It was a very cumbersome model. It's much emulated now, but it took a long time, over 10 years. And you start with the debate about whether or not we should make children by IVF and what the status of embryos were. And you have that debate in public, and you make sure that everybody's heard. And this is what we did in the United Kingdom. And it took more than 10 years from the publication of the Warnock Report, which was considerably after the birth of Louise Brown, even to get that 10-year program. As it happens, it was a 10-year, it wasn't envisaged as 10 years, it just took 10 years for the Human Fertilisation and Embryology Act 1990 to be passed. And it was only passed because 10 years of very widespread debate took place. And while there wasn't consent, while there wasn't agreement, there was a consensus that it should go ahead with a framework of regulation, and all of that was developed in that sort of time. But you first have to say, is this a good idea, and should we think about it, and what are the arguments against it? And you know, you can have somebody who's like me, who is likes, as my son would say, going off on one, pursuing some idea, and then you have very sensible people saying, but what about this and what about that? And we're just at the very early stages of the what about this and what about that stage of the argument. And I may turn that to be entirely wrong, and fine if I am. If and to the extent to which the ideas have legs, as is sometimes said, if we're going to run with them, then we have to start developing some sort of conception of how we might implement this, what the safeguards would be, and then we have to have all of the sorts of issues. Well, we certainly don't want to do all of this at once, and we want to have it regulated, and we want to have monitoring, and we want to have possibly your mates in Wisconsin or wherever it is licensed, and their protocols approved by not just, you know, putting, not just introducing a carbon to silicone, but getting a contract by which the carbon agrees to X and the silicone agrees to Y, and we have a contract that satisfies everybody. But you're absolutely right. That is, I don't even think that's the next stage. I mean, I think we're way behind that with this particular set of ideas. But they are beginning to be talked about. Lots of people are interested on both sides of the debate about enhancement, as was the case with embryology. And that will continue for quite a considerable time before anything like a program could conceivably be approved, even within the nation state.
I agree completely. One last comment then. Do you think there's a role for academic, I mean, I'm not familiar with the literature, but is there a role for a purpose-built journal to start raising these kinds of issues around setting an agenda, where you would encourage politicians, academics, and others to actually contribute articles to, let's say, a journal called something like, I don't know, The New Species, whatever you want to title it?
Well, there is, and I think in a way that's one of the problems. There is a subgroup of people who are not very dissimilar to me, who self-consciously regard themselves as post-humanists. Now, I've never used that term to describe myself, because for me, being post-human is not the goal. It's a means to a different sort of end. It's a means to survival. If we can survive by staying exactly human, then that's fine with me too. But post-humans actually want post-humanism for a large range of other reasons. So I don't think we need one journal. I think there's quite a lot of different ways of thinking about this, and the post-humanists may be right. I happen not to share their agenda, but they may be right. I think of myself, you may not think that having heard me speak, but I think of myself as relatively pragmatic about this. I'm not wishing to impose it on anybody. I'm not doing it myself. I've advocated the use of cognitive enhancement drugs, but I don't take them myself. I just think that people should have the liberty to choose whether to take them or not. And so, in answer to your big question, is the role of the academy in all of this? I think it has a big role, but also it's much wider than the academy. I mean, it's for the academy, but again, the academy is underplaying its role in what used to be called the public understanding of science, but is now called all sorts of other things. But that's a second role for the academy, but the debate has to move outside the academy, obviously. But like lots of other areas, I hope people will be informed by what people like the people in the group think is the right way to think about these issues. Thank you very much.
Now I have a very unpopular task to close the debate, at least here in this auditorium. But those of you who would like to continue an informal debate, there will be a kind of modest reception at the another 13 building, so you can still have a chance to ask informal questions from the lecturer. And I am very happy that CEU for the 20th anniversary we managed to engage in such a multidisciplinary debates. In previous conferences when I used to attend, and often there is a legal conference or a gender conference or a political science conference, and now I've seen faces from all different types of departments, and I think it's already sure a success and interest to multidisciplinary research fields such as the topic was for the today's discussion. So please keep your interest in these topics and come for the other lectures after this opening lecture. I'm sure that we cannot really conclude the debate at this point because for various reasons for which we might disagree, but other good reasons for enhancement. Sometimes there are traditional reasons just as to maintain of the diversity. I heard some people using cloning, for instance, in order to maintain the previously existing diversity, and some various other reasons, curiosity or even sometimes very selfish reasons we would like to use these technologies. But the last word is a word for gratitude. We are very grateful for John for coming here and to share your views with the CEU's community and to give an inspiring lecture, which I think that after reading your books and using in several course materials in the philosophy department, gender, political science, legal studies, and other faculty sociology also, then we are very happy that we had a chance to see you in person, and please come back more often to Budapest. Thank you very much for being
here. Well, thank you. I would just like to say that for me it's been great fun, and I think that's the chief reason for doing anything that we humans actually have, never mind the science.